Hey, I'd like to call this meeting of the Select Board to order on October 3rd at 6 o'clock. Additions and deletions.
I don't know anything.
Anyone? Okay. Citizens' comments, unless it has to do with the water department, because that's coming up next.
So this is where we talk about anything
If
not
you.
on the agenda. If you have anything, come on up
Yes.
and make sure to state your name for the record.
The wheel.
Hi. I'm Jesse Werner, resident of the town of Woodstock and business owner. I'm curious. Can I ask questions of you at this time? So I'm curious about marijuana in the town of Woodstock, and I just want to know how many approvals have been given by the local cannabis control board, which is you guys. I mean, I think Sunday Drive, I think Woolly Mammoth. I was wondering if there was a third.
So state statute gives a lot of confidentiality to marijuana businesses. And before I answer that question, I want to make sure that I'm not revolving anything that should stay confidential.
I think anything we've approved should be on previously approved would be on former agendas, would it
Yes.
not? Yeah. So I went through today and I didn't see anything as of May of this year other than the aforementioned applications, but maybe I'm wrong.
Okay, I mean, I keep reading in the paper that there's a third place opening, and I'm very surprised. I think the n residents of that neighborhood in West Woodstock are very surprised at what they're reading. And I think there's been some, pushback. I know there's been an official appeal launched against, filed against issuing the permit with the State Environmental Court. So I know that that's ongoing, and I just was trying to get some clarity because I don't know where to read or where to find out what is happening or what is really going on. It seems like there's parts of town that are correctly zoned for it, maybe some that aren't. I think some neighbors were really surprised in that they didn't know what the usage would be, and I don't think the usage was ever revealed. In speaking with the Development Review Board, they didn't even know that it was going to be a cannabis usage until that meeting. And I just think that wasn't properly warning it. And without a proper warning, no one could show up to know what was going on. So it was almost kind of like a permit issued in stealth. And I think there's been an appeal filed to deal with that. And I was just curious. I think the local, the Cannabis Control Board is the town select board in this instance. So I was just curious. And
State,
yeah.
everything goes through the state.
Yep. I mean, I know that you have to approve before the select board and get approval. And I don't think you can do that with any ongoing like appeals or any legal issues to anything like that. And I think you have, I mean, the license is a very long process and there's like a bunch of steps in it and they're all supposed to be very transparent. So, there can be no appeals, there can be no legal, questions ongoing. You have to be properly permitted and zoned. And just one of those things is the approval from the select board. And, if there's any appeals ongoing, maybe it has to be tabled until those are finished. I really didn't know. I was just trying to get some clarity and.
I mean, I think like with everything, we will be we'll take the advice of counsel. We're not given much leeway in terms of cannabis retail, where we either approve it or we de facto do not take action and therefore approve it. So we're given very little leeway, and I'm happy to send you the statute, but the State Cannabis Control Commission, as if Susan were here, she would love to point this out, and she's not. Same with liquor licenses, gives us actually with liquor licenses we have more power, but for cannabis retail we have very little power as the local cannabis commission.
Well, you actually have a lot of power, actually, because every local cannabis commission, every applicant has to appear before them and seek their approval. And if there's any appeals or anything like that,
After they get state approval.
yeah, as part of the license, without an approval from the local cannabis control board, you can't get the license.
Yeah, well, we don't have anything on our agenda tonight for a license, and like I said, you can find, I believe the state permits are actually listed online on a map view on the state website. As for the Town Development Review Board appeal, there are statutory requirements for those appeal processes, but legally we can't discriminate. The town cannot discriminate against any particular retail usage. So that's on that.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you for the information.
If
you want to speak, just please stand up and
We
say
just
your
have
name.
for the minutes. And I'll say, because I've gotten some letters. Yeah, I'm happy to meet with folks on this topic. You know, I've gotten letters today about this, and I understand that there are neighbor concerns, and I'm happy to explain the process to people and our role in it.
The way the process
You
works,
state your name, please.
my name is Leo Werner. The process requires, in order to get a license, it requires not only the approval of the Vermont Cannabis Control Board, it requires the approval of the local Cannabis Control Board, which is synonymous.
And nobody has come here for approval, right?
Okay, that's it. So I just want to make sure that if and when they come, that we all know about it. Because, as Jesse said, when I went and talked to the folks at the Town Development Review Board, nobody knew what the retail license they want. Nobody knew what they were doing in terms of what changed. Give me the reason for it. It was never revealed until the meeting. And nobody showed up, of course, because nobody knew. So that's something I just don't want to have happen again. And it's all right to issue a permit or a license as long as it's transparent and everybody knows what's going on. So that's all. Which actually, the appeal is based on the fact that there was a lack of transparency, a lack of adequate warning, and there you go. And now it's in the environmental court, and we'll see what they say. But there, again, there's just too much rumor going around here. Like, you know, oh, yes. Oh, no. Yes, they have it. Oh, they're opening tomorrow. No, they're opening on October the.
How long have you lived in Woodstock?
Pardon me?
How long have you lived in Woodstock?
Oh, the last 5 years.
Okay, so every year there's probably been 20 rooms, so of some sort of or another.
Okay, no, not a problem. You know, I mean, one of the things is when you look at it, there is a town plan, there is zoning. That particular area where Sleep Woodstock is actually zoned residential, and the restaurant is there, was there, and it's a conditional use only because it's there. If you're going to do violence to the zoning and the town plan, I would think that the people of Woodstock have a right to be heard. It may be an appropriate thing to warn for the annual meeting.
I can assure
Nothing
you.
Has
I,
come in
no,
front of
he's
this
talking
board.
about the TDRB. Yeah. I can assure you it was properly warned. If you don't feel that way, good luck with your appeal. But we followed statutory requirements.
Okay.
Feel differently. Again, best of luck with your appeal.
Okay.
The local cannabis control commission, this is from our local planning authority. The local cannabis control commission's authority is so tightly restricted by the state that our only option is the local cannabis control is to rubber stamp the zoning permit decision.
You can only rubber stamp
under state regulations.
Okay.
State regulations prohibit municipalities from treating cannabis businesses any different from non-cannabis businesses. So
right.
That may have been the rationale for not to
but they have
of the retail business.
But
again,
they have to come in front of you to get that, whether it's a rubber stamp or not.
Yes, and we don't have anything in front of us.
They haven't done it. Okay, that's all I needed to really know. And there you go. That's good. We'll see what happens. Okay.
Hey, thank you.
You're very welcome.
Any other comments? Okay. Onward to the discussion of the acquisition of the Africa.
Yeah, Laura, did you want to share the capital projects? Laura Paul has put together kind of a brief summary of some of the capital projects the board is aware of that potentially could be on the second vote, but the first capital vote. And so we thought it'd be appropriate for us to kind of go over those. After today, this will be on our website so people to look at, but kind of gives us a better sense of, well, I'm going to give you. You should be sharing now.
Thanks.
So a lot of these projects we have talked publicly already about in the presentation last week and over the course of the last 2 weeks and public discussions But kind of for the record, that would be beneficial to kind of go over this now. So
Yeah.
Laura, go ahead.
Okay. So I put this doc together. It's just an explainer of some of the capital projects that we've talked about publicly that are outlined. Yeah, I'll make it bigger. Thanks. Trying to make it as big as I can for everybody. Is that good?
Yeah.
Everybody in the room? Try to make it a little bit bigger. Okay. So a lot of these were outlined in the engineering report that was prepared last year from Otter Creek Engineering. And some of this is additional information. And again, I'll share this and post this on the website under the aqueducts. As a lot of you know, and as a lot of you see every day, I guess the first most visible one would be suspending the main under the Elm Street Bridge. Obviously in Irene, and again, last year, the water main that ran under the Ottoquechee first. In both cases, we experienced a loss of pressure to the system, and it left us without water, either usable water or potable water, for almost 2 weeks. The aqueduct wants to pursue a more flood resilient solution after the flooding of last year. That's why we have the pipe over the bridge right now. If you recall, that it was one time just like a long hydrant, a long fire hose that connected the hydrants as well. And the idea would be replacing this with an insulated pipe that would be suspended under the bridge instead of being buried under the riverbed to protect it from the impact of future flooding events. I think this is one of the cheaper projects. It's also the most visible. And although we don't have a duration up there, I believe it's the quickest,
potentially, yes.
Potentially the quickest one we have. The next one is a new well and pump replacement. So for those that don't know, right now we have three wells, only two of which are active. And Otter Creek suggested replacing well number 5, which was installed in the early 90s. It will be a new, very deep gravel-packed well, and that will help us meet our, these are two measurements that they use within water engineering systems, average day demand and maximum daily demand. Right now, the pump meets those in 18 hours, and with the new well and pump, we can meet those in 12 hours, which would create a reserve capacity. Some of these are more familiar. This option is referred to as 1B, but also encompasses 1A. It is replacing the water main. It's not really a replacement, and I'll explain why, but it is replacement in the utilization sense. We would replace the main right now that goes down cross country, and we don't have direct mapping where it goes from the top of the, from the tank to Route 4, and the idea would be that we would replace the use of that pipe. We wouldn't replace that pipe exactly because we want to follow the road with a larger main that would go all the way down Cox District and then along Route 4, so that future maintenance would be easier. The existing line would remain undisturbed throughout that construction process because of that. And again, that include option 1B includes 1A as well. And the upgrades, these specific upgrades are projected to bring at least 87% of the fire hydrants into compliance with the increase in water pressure, we hope. Another project that's talked about in the engineering report is a new water storage tank. It's on the east end of one of the, we're looking at a few sites for this, but it would be on the east end of Woodstock. Like I said, those are where the pumps and the wells are right now. So right now the water is pumped from those wells along Route 12 all the way to Cox District Road, which is not really super efficient. And the fact that we only have one tank exposes us to, you know, a lots of risk should we have events like fires, outage, or pump failure, or the water tank burst itself. So constructing a second tank on that side of the distribution system at the same elevation would address those vulnerabilities and also increase water pressure to meet those fire flow requirements. It also has the possibility of expanding the service area for the future water system. This would also require the town to purchase land at one of those four sites that meet the design and engineering requirements. There's only a few that would be at that elevation. And they've been identified in the by Otter Creek, but kept confidential. Something else a lot of folks have been asking about is the upgrades of water mains. Obviously, with the idea that, you know, we have aging infrastructure, with the purchase of the aqueduct, you know, maintenance is an ongoing thing. And so about two thirds of the water mains right now are more than 100 years old. And about half of them are only 8 inches in diameter or larger. So we want to develop a plan to replace the undersized ones that will continue to support better flow into the town and failing sections of the water mains, and build the cost of those improvements into a new rate structure, which we'll talk about. The good news about this is that, you know, if we own the water and the sewer, we can consider upgrading certain things at the same time while we have the ground exposed. And like I said, there's always going to be ongoing infrastructure maintenance. Like owning a house, there's a lot of proactive work and there's a lot of reactive work. Our service area is sizable, and I think that there's a lot of things that we're going to find out after we own it, and we're excited to get to work on those things and identify those and build those into the capital plan. So like I said, we're going to put this sheet online. This will be available for folks, but happy to answer questions about these specific projects, or do we want to take other questions too?
Yeah, we can open up to all questions if you want.
Well, it's very short.
Yeah. Any questions? Come on up, state your name. Is anyone, how many people on Zoom?
Like 10 people on Zoom.
Byron Kelly is my name. I'm from Woodstock. First of all, I want to thank the selectmen for all of the work, and I want to thank the working group. And I really would recommend people to read what's online, because once you do that, you understand that. Thank you for what you did tonight, because that was most of my questions.
Sure.
The other thing is, I didn't see an inventory of what we would be purchasing. Now, I know what we're purchasing, but
yeah,
you know, all the wells are involved, everything involved. I do believe that 1B is the option you want to look at, and I think it's okay to tell people that, because there seems to be a 30% loss potentially right now from
the system, yeah,
from Cox District down into the village.
Yep.
I mean, that's a big loss.
Huge.
And
yeah,
with that being corrected, if 1B, is my understanding, corrects that, as well as you still have the old pipe as a backup, if that's even feasible as a backup. So I think that's really good. My biggest questions are, as you talk about this, is in the working group, and the working group did a fantastic job, is the funding of it. I do absolutely, personally, agree that the town should purchase the aqueduct. I do believe that the town should figure out the responsibility that they have for 1B.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no talk of how is it going to be funded. I mean, I read about the current funding and what it is.
Mm-hmm.
I read about how Vermont has one of the concerns in the working group was the affordability for people.
Yeah.
With the increase. But there's also a income sensitivity that's built into that,
mm-hmm,
that no one's really talked about unless you read the report, and even then is I'm assuming the board has at least somewhere discussed what they think they're going to be presenting as soon as this vote assumed passes, but it's going to be a surprise, and that surprise is going to offend people.
Yeah,
because you're not talking about it, and that's a really big concern. I do think the 30% loss is something that's not mentioned a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And the inventory are the two two questions I have.
Perfect. Do
I'm
you want to
happy
talk
to.
about the inventory?
Yeah, I do both.
Oh, and also, the engineering report was 90% done when it was done in 2023. This is a year later. What's the 10% that wasn't done? And what have we found since? I mean, sort of like buying a used car.
Yeah, for sure.
We have the 100% report. We just need to put it online. The 91 is from previous, so we'll update that. When it comes to assets, there's actually a piece of paper right where you are. They'll list off a lot of the assets. We will put that online. But if you give me 1 second, I can pull some up.
Sure.
I'm not going to share, but I'll read off. And those two sheets will go be online sometime tomorrow as well. So just kind of give you a rundown. There's obviously some inventory like pipes, valves, fittings, et cetera. There's an excavator. There's a trailer for the excavator. There's a skid steer. There's a water tank, some pumps, solar tractors, a second well and equipment, John Deere lawn tractor, the West End Loop material, various tools, the billing system, and then a few other software systems as well. And those come out to a rough value of about $2.7 million estimated. Anything, sorry.
I have a question. I want to read the 100%
engineer.
Yeah, we can do that for you, yeah.
But I don't know. I just think that's something that's wise for people to be educated on.
Yeah, and usually just so you reference, usually 90% is when it's completed and then they let people review it before they make the final changes. But we will get that for you.
Right. Yeah. I mean, and the only reason I say that is because some of the stuff that you mentioned tonight was mentioned in that report. They're currently doing the new well upgrade. They're currently relining. They had relined the tank up there, but it needs to be relined or checked every so. I mean, what's the status of that now?
Yeah.
Those are things.
Those are good questions. Yeah.
And then to your second question about funding, I think this is the first meeting the select board has had since they announced this acquisition deal. We have talked about different ways to fund it. And part of the question about the overall cost to the taxpayer is going to be what capital projects are decided on to be on that first bond vote. So that's going to play a large part on how it's going to be subsidized by taxpayers. Some discussion tonight is how we want to fund those projects. So if you stick around all night, you'll hear some of those conversations as well.
And right now, the town pays for part of the water department to pay for all the hydrants.
Thanks, Byron.
Thank you. Any other questions? You went online? Nope. Come on up.
Hi, Peter Shoemaker. So I just wanted to figure out how this company's been run and what revenue has it generated over the years. Has it generated a surplus? And obviously, with two-thirds of the infrastructure, the pipes, not over 100 years old, there wasn't a plan really in the past to upgrade and keep up with things. So was there revenue generated that was not set aside for that? And will there be revenue coming from this when the town takes it over that will fund this project? You know, whether it's through usage fees, was there an excess of revenue that was paid out to shareholders, I guess would be my question over the years. So if so, when did that start? Was there a time where they realized that maybe we should be investing money in the infrastructure, but they haven't? Or did that continue right up to, I understand Irene, and I understand the flood last year were changes, right? Everything's just crazy.
Yeah.
But besides that, we can say that the $900,000 that we're paying to buy the company, that's kind of a debt that they accumulated without really maintaining anything. So I wonder how much revenue was created and where did that revenue go to once the town takes it over? With that revenue, you talked about funding. I think this gentleman talked about funding. And I echo everything he says about this. We it's such a shame that the garish property at the end of town could be a wonderful addition to this town with affordable housing, but we can't do anything. And the Mellishwood, I mean, that's a wonderful thing. Would there be other revenue generated when upgrades go out and businesses connect to this system? I know a lot of towns, they charge a fee to connect to it, right? So if someone wants to go out there and develop for profit, say the garish property, unlike Mellishwood, which is here to subsidize and keep people, you know, people can age gracefully in their own town. And that's a very difficult thing to do in Vermont. It's tough. You've asked about how long I've lived in. I've owned my house for 22 years. My wife and I rented before that. We lived at an inn that we ran. So I grew up in Windsor, Vermont. So I'm very familiar with going on in this town. And I just feel like I'm really kind of shocked that the water system has gotten to the point that it did and it was never realized. I mean, I got to think a little failure somewhere. And I'm not saying whoever, but that's crazy. I mean, it really is. So I got to wonder if the next buyout for the first one is to take over the debt, then if we're buying another section of property, why isn't that included with taking over their debt? And they're just walk away and say, you get to walk away clear and free with no debt. And, you know, a water system that was, we could use many terms, but now we have to say, oh, but we're going to pay you extra for this. It's just at some point in time, I'd like to know what the revenue was brought in and where that revenue went to and how come it wasn't with 2/3 of the system still 100-year-old pipes. I find it rather shocking that water system has been losing money all those years. I don't know. But where did that go to? So I guess I don't think it's rumors, but it's gone on, whether it's social media or whatever you want to talk about it, where's the 1.9? Why are we doing that? I mean, I guess would be the second part. And again, I know this has to be done. And I live up on Gardner Way up Carlton Hill. You know, I got to pay to have my own well drilled. And I already had to have that done once when I lived up there, you know, and it's paid to get fracked. It's a tough thing and I have to absorb that cost. And I understand the fire hydrant and I do believe in that safety as well. But I have to wonder if you have to look at saying, I got a beat up truck in my yard that I did not take care of and a transmission went, but I want to sell that truck. Like, all you got to do is fix the transmission, but then you got to give me $2,000 for the rest of the truck when it's really not worth that. So that's all I have to say.
Yeah, I'll try to answer all your questions. One, I once have the 1.9 million. I too don't know where that came from because we've never said 1.9 million.
Not a number.
It's not a number we've ever discussed publicly or privately. So I use this opportunity to say the listserv is not factual. People can post whatever they want on the listserv, and that's their right to do that. I would ask people, if you have questions about this acquisition, come to these meetings, come to the meetings we're holding in the public. Almost every morning at a cafe in Woodstock. We're doing happy hours at night. We're going to be at South Woodstock Fire Station next Tuesday. I'm in Taftsville on the 23rd. We're going to be everywhere we can be to answer these questions and make sure you have all the facts. So when you vote, you're voting with all the information. What you're going to listserv is just what people want to write, and there's no fact checking. And we're not going to spend our time fact checking people on the listserv because then that'll be our whole day and we're not going to get anything done. So just the 1.9 just came from nowhere. I just want people to be aware of $920,000 of debts for the acquisition of the water company. And then $1.6 million for Vondel. Those are the two numbers we're talking about, then the capital projects. To go all the way back, one of the issues the company has is they have not increased user rates since 2016. Imagine what state this town would be in if we did not increase taxes since 2016. We'd be running out of deficits. That's one of the major issues. They never increased rates over the last 8 years, which has caused them to have less and less excess revenue to go against their expenses. We had Gallagher Flynn, which is an auditing company that audits the state of Vermont, come in the spring and did an audit of the last 3 years of the financials of the aqueduct.
If I might, because we had the same concerns you did.
Yes.
We're in the same position. We very much were like, what's going on? We want to understand how we got to this point. So I just want to say, like, we're with you totally and 100%.
Yeah, the select board allocated a decent amount of money to make sure we were very, very confident with the financials.
Yeah.
What you see if you look at their balance sheets was them getting by year by year, less and less each year, because they weren't bringing in any new revenue and their expenses were going up. So there'll be years where they ran a deficit of $15,000. Next year, a surplus of $26,000. That's kind of where they've been the last few years from all the records we have. So they've never really put the money in to kind of gain extra money. So because they were doing that, they weren't raising enough revenue. They had to then go out and get loans to do any work they had to do because they had no excess capital. So the $920,000, that is the new pipe in West Woodstock they put in a few years ago. It's money from this past flood. And the flood in July, when they do emergency work, they had no excess capital money to use. So they had to go get an emergency loan to pay for that work. It's for system improvements over the last few years, the solar panel for the excavator, for the lead line inventory they're doing, for the engineering report we talked about earlier. They basically had to go out and get money to loan to cover all these expenses because they weren't raising enough revenue day in, day out or by user fees and hydrant fees. So that's where that debt came from. That's how they've been run. That's why they're in the situation they're in right now. When it comes to the town running it, one of the first things the town is going to do is make sure they're at capital reserves. They're going to raise enough money to put money aside for emergency work. So when something happens, we don't have to go and bond for it. We have the money right there, like any municipality should do for the water, sewer, and for their town funds. Talking about more money, after these original first few projects, as Laura said, potentially the tank, and we can have new connections. Right now, there are no new connections in the village or anywhere else. One, yes, connection fees, absolutely. Two, people aren't using the water will pay rates, so revenue from them. Then three, if we have new housing, we have a larger grant list, which means more tax revenue and more money coming in that way. So there is a chance to make more money owning this if we follow those steps.
And we want to.
We want to.
We want to run this as a successful
profitable business.
public utility.
Yeah,
can you follow up on?
Can you come back to the podium? Just so we can hear you on Zoom. Yeah, sorry.
All right. So they haven't raised rates. A couple of questions. So they haven't raised rates in 2016 on.
And I was in historically
low,
abysmally low, even before 2016. Okay. What we've paid historically for water has been nothing really as users. And so
compared to other towns or municipalities,
exactly,
we're very low. So how low? I mean, would you say if their rates increase, water usage in town increased 50%, that would bring them in line with surrounding?
In front of the PUC for at least doubling their rates.
Yes.
Now.
And
that's at least what they need.
But have you compared, what do we like? And I don't say Hanover or Lebanon. Maybe think Windsor. Windsor's put a lot of work into theirs. Similar size town, I think.
The Water Work Group did do that work. I don't have that data right in front of me, but we can get it for you. They actually looked at and reviewed that themselves.
So I guess I would look at it in the sense that if there is a proposal to move forward, hopefully, I guess people have used water right now. They won't be shocked if we talk to them now and say that you've been paying really not a lot for water. So when you get ready to start paying some more, don't complain so much because this is what other towns pay.
Yeah.
So I think that that's something that has to
be
put out.
Oh, I think that's been a part of our messaging. We've been out. I mean, we were out at the Village Green yesterday, and a lot of the conversations, I'm a ratepayer. Everybody understands that we are underpaying severely for water.
And we said that we had the engineer here a few months ago, and he gave a presentation and he finished. And I stopped him and said, just to be clear, rates have to go up. And he said, no matter who owns the company, rates have to go up. And so we've been trying to be as clear as possible that has to happen.
Yep.
And then, I was on the water working group, and Woodstock is like middle and below in terms of like state water rates.
So, and I guess I understand the ranking, but I would like to know by percent, right? You know, if someone else is paying $1 for a gallon and I'm only paying 50 cents, am I going to be shocked when my rates double, but I'm just like everyone else now? It's nothing that we're not asking anyone to pay more than, actually, it may have to be $1.25 to catch up for the usage that you didn't have to pay, you know, the amount you didn't pay before. So I do feel bad for someone who just moved here 4 years ago or 3 years ago when after COVID and bought. But for someone who's been living in their house for 25 or 30 years, you've been paying a pretty cheap rate for all that long time. So don't be shocked if we don't just go to the dollar to catch up, but we got to go to a dollar 25 to make up for all the improvements. Because a lot of other towns that are doing the dollar, and these are just examples, the dollars, they put capital reserves. They don't have 100-year-old, you know, they put in plans to upgrade every 5 years a section, do this, do that. You know, we did tear Route 4 up not too long ago. For years, I had to drive with wonderful potholes and get my wheel bearings and get an alignment every other year. And I live on a dirt road, and I thought that was worse going through the potholes there. But I was always told, you know, if we fix the road, the state will never help. But we did have a chance there. I mean, that wasn't too long ago to upgrade. So I hope.
If I can interrupt you 1 second on that, that's a great point that we're trying to make too, is when we're doing work like that in the town, whether it's for roads or sewer or water pipe, to step back and say, okay, if we're going to tear up this road, let's also fix the pipes of sewer and water all at the same time. Rather than now, water goes in, tears up the road, fix the pipe, paves it over, we come back 3 years later for the sewer and do the same thing, and really try to work together to make sure that we're doing work efficiently and saving money in the process.
So I guess, and I'll try and give other people time. And so I guess as we, if you move forward and the parties move forward, I think the information that come forward to say to me is where the revenue is coming from. I don't mind paying a little extra for the fire hydrants and stuff, but I don't think the fire hydrant should carry the. And my wife works in town at a restaurant, so I understand that, and I know there's a lot of business that draws people here. But for sake of business, they've been getting cheaper product. They, I mean, you know, they got to buy their toilet paper for half the amount that everyone else got to buy their toilet paper for. So now they got to pay more for their toilet paper to make up for the broken toilet paper dispensers that they didn't fix over the year. So I guess that's I would just like to know as you move forward. I think that would be helpful. I wish I could. I don't drink coffee, so I don't know. I got to get up and talk. But that's why I'll come here. Again, I think this is a project that has to move forward. I just think if we can get out ahead of it, for me and others, is where that revenue is coming from and how that's going to go. And then I guess the second question I had is you only went back 3 years to look. I don't know, was there a 50-year or 60-year? Because, you know, 50 years ago, they probably shouldn't have been upgrading. Was there, how was the money being, revenue being spent then?
Okay, thank you.
How do we ask a question? Raise our hand. Those on Zoom.
Go for it.
Oh, okay. My name is Linda Smitty. My husband and I are both residents of Woodstock Village, and we have lived here for 38 years. And I have three questions. I have tried to keep up with reading what has been published. Unfortunately, because of constraints, personal constraints, it's very difficult for me to get to the special meet or the local meetings that are being held, but I salute you all very, very much for doing that. It's a very helpful community service. I just have really three questions. And one is, I would like to step back and look sort of globally at what has happened this fall, adding on, of course, to the fact that everybody's taxes went up to the tune of 30%. But first of all, I don't understand why the select board chose to have us address the fire engines, the school, and the water system in a what I will call a divide and conquer approach. It seems to me that, and I want to say I really appreciate all the work you all have done, and I appreciate the fact that you're willing to serve on the board and deal with issues of this magnitude. But It seems to me that it would make more sense, or would have made more sense, since all of these are coming, these projects are coming up for a vote within a few months of each other. You all have the information in hand and have it now. So why not list for the before we vote on anything, make a list of all of these projects. And number one, decide what the priority among them is. Now, implicitly, there's been a decision that the school is the most important, although because it went first, but I can't imagine why that would be more important than the water system. Secondly, for each project, list what its actual cost, what the debt is going to be, and what the service of that debt is going to be. In other words, the total burden to the Woodstock taxpayers. And three, make it specific about how much our taxes are going to go up. And we don't have that information. That is the way people plan. And then we can, when we vote, we can decide what are our priorities. Do we agree with the ones that are posted? We can decide if the total tax burden is something we can bear. We can decide if we feel that in discussions like that, if we feel that the cost of these projects is really worth it to take on all at once. I am not just disputing the significance of these projects. Secondly, I have seen no real evidence that public ownership would be better than private ownership. Yes, I'm sorry, I forgot to mention, yes, I'm aware of the grants available under public ownership. But the water company is currently under private ownership, and for years it has not been maintained, and now the taxpayers are left holding the bag and forced to vote with their backs against the wall. And I mean financial wall, because we've just incurred a 30% tax increase. Secondly, we have fire engines that we're going to have to buy. And they also have been neglected to the point that we no longer are going to be state compliant. Third, we have the school. The school was also neglected until the point that it's presented as an emergency. So I want to know what evidence there is, other than the grants, that public ownership is going to be any better than private. In both situations, the situations we are facing today were created by long-term neglect. And if the neglect is that long-term, public entity, public servants and private owners knew of the problem well in advance. So I think there's a bit of a scare tactic at work that is really very unappealing. And my last point is, I'd like to know what the total actual cost through the taxpayers is. For example, there's been a lot of talk about the cost, the purchase price of the water system, the upfront ones, and the assumption of $10 million worth of debt, and the debt service. We know nothing about the total cost of that debt service. Is it going to have to be refinanced? What is the debt service in present value dollars? Secondly, $10 million assumption of debt is income to the seller.
So if that, can I interrupt you for 1 second? Because that's not correct. The assumption of debt is $920,000. And that money is not going to the owners, it's going to their banks to wipe off their debts. So the $10 million is not a number about debts. The debt number is $920,000, and that's going to the banks, not the owners of the company.
Okay, well, whatever the debt is, I stand corrected, and I appreciate it. But whatever the total amount of debt is, and the cost of debt service, the wiping off owner's debt is income to them, and according to the IRS, it's income to them, and so it's part of the purchase price.
Okay, Linda, we'll answer those questions. We have a lot of people that still have questions to ask.
I'm done, but I just want to say thank you all. I do appreciate your service. I also want to know if the small meetings here and all the different places, are the answers going to be on the record for people who can't attend every one of those meetings, listen to the questions?
So we don't have the technology to be online when we're at a cafe or something like that, unfortunately.
No, I'm not suggesting. Is anybody going to be taking notes and posting notes on the website?
Yeah, we're working on posting. I think we're working on posting a fact sheet as well as frequently asked questions and the previous document that we went over tonight, the explainer with all this, with all the explanation will be posted online.
Okay, what about all the questions?
We'll answer those questions as we're going. There's other people that have questions. We don't want to be here till 10 o'clock tonight.
I'm happy to quickly answer a question.
Linda, thank you so much. And I think you're apt to point out that there's a theme here of neglect. But I think I would challenge you to reframe it because I think it didn't necessarily happen consciously. I think that over many years, the argument that we are here today exploring again, which is affordability, has been used to delay decisions and delay projects and work that should have been done long time ago. And so we are right now forced to make up for that in a way that will challenge the affordability of living here ultimately. And that is because that argument has been used so much in the past. And I would say for clarification, we don't have anything to do with the school. We don't oversee the district. We have nothing to do with the school bond, and the timing of that. The fire trucks have not been neglected. They have been around for a while and we're trying to bring them into what we feel like, might be regulations that are coming online this coming year. And we've created, a plan.
Every vehicle has a lifespan.
Every vehicle has a lifespan. Yeah, and yeah, we've decided to move forward with the replacement of one of those trucks, and not buy a ladder truck because we felt that owning the water company and working on fire department retention would be the best thing we could do for fire safety. And I don't think you're wrong to ask the questions of what these things cost. A lot of these capital projects don't have lock-in costs. I mean, we are still working with the engineering firm for the wastewater treatment plant. Those costs change on a daily, unfortunately, basis based on like supply chain issues. And so please believe that we would like to give the voters as much information as fast as possible, as soon as possible. And I hear your point that we need to, let voters know that what this will cost them. But I would challenge folks to also understand that the place that we're in now and the decisions we're making now are because these conversations happened year after year over a period of years where people were saying the exact same thing you're saying and saying, we cannot afford to make these investments. And so now it's up to us to decide, unfortunately, what to do with that.
Pardon me, I am not saying you can't afford this. I am saying I would like those questions answered and priorities set before we're asked to vote. These are very important questions.
Yeah.
I'm saying I think it's perhaps I was not articulate enough, and I do apologize, but that's the case. But raising these questions should not be construed as opposition. It should be construed as I think that was
Sorry, Linda,
important.
your microphone. Do you mind speaking up? We missed the last part.
I just said raising questions such as this should not be characterized as opposition, but merely inquiry so that we can be as informed voters as possible. I
Absolutely.
don't. I'm perfectly happy to shut down now, and I want to give other people a chance. So thank you very much.
Thank you. And we'll
Thank you.
put more stuff online for you so you for you to review as well.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's a couple chats. Those are questions or
Those are DMs to Eric, I think. We don't have public chat enabled.
one up, state your name.
Good evening. My name is John King. I live at 51 Watkins Way, Unit 2. I did the last development before they shut off the water. I did two duplexes in Vermont, in Woodstock, up in Lincoln Street. So I have a firsthand experience. I was the first advocate to make sure we do buy the water company. We really don't have an option based on my experience. My support had always been on the revenue. In order for us to pay all our bills, we need to build more housing and to do it. So I want to thank you all for all your service and all the things you've done. Eric, I think it's excellent, all your meetings. I'm really grateful for that. I'm also consulting on another project in the village with a potential 8 duplexes for workforce houses that I don't really see moving forward. I think the challenge that we have is the cost of building is so out of control. Most people don't understand it. Most people here don't understand it. I'm unique in the sense that I'm the only one that builds houses to sell. The 98% of all homes built today are rentals. So that's in 10 years, we're going to have a flood of rental units. That could be converted to housing, but that's not really helping us now. The challenge I have here is there will be no new building happening here in Woodstock, other than the affluent, very rich. That's just a fact. I mean, it's if you we have all these meetings and we're looking, you know, at all the things that we need to do, it's just not going to happen. It's just so expensive. I received my tax bill. It is unbelievably high. We just have a new instituted 3.5% excise tax. So anybody selling their homes, the person coming in is going to be paying, you know, 3.5% sales tax on it. Most people, because we haven't had our taxes reappraised, they're not really experiencing the thing. But if you build something new, you bought a new house, you see it. Anybody buying a house today, they can afford those taxes. Most people can't. My concern is, you talked about it, and I think it's great. What is the potential for new revenue? Well, if we can't build and we have all this infrastructure we need to do, which I think is really important, we need water, we need upgrades of our sewer. The school is another challenge. Again, I was supporting that. It is there's no one moving in here for new housing if we can't build it. It's not going to happen. So I think we need to be honest with all the community that housing will not be happening. In fact, affordable housing that are nonprofits cost $200 a square foot more than the free market. So if it's $650 a square foot for affordable projects, it's $450 for high end. So those are the numbers. I think we just need to be realistic on that. So if we can't build moving forward and we're doing all this infrastructure, The only way out of this is getting new revenue. The Upper Valley needs about 15,000 houses to support Dartmouth-Hitchcock, which is short 2,000 employees. It's just not going to happen. And it's a federal level, it's a state level, and it's a local level. I just want to make sure that's important. Now, I do still believe we need to buy the water department. It's important. The only issue I have just the concept is when something's been given to you, it's never easy. I say it's never easy money. If you're giving something, whether it's an estate, a trust fund, or whatever, that's a very difficult responsibility. That's why second generation lose 70% of the wealth, third loses 90. The challenge we have is the 1.6 million for that land. That's like a golden parachute. With the responsibility of the ownership for multi-generation, it's a lot of responsibility. So that's an ethical, moral question that has to be answered among those stakeholders. But personally, I don't think that is equitable or a fair moral thing, because you had an asset that was given to you, and if it's worthless and we take the debt, which I think we should do, but to cut them a check for 1.6 million is ethically and morally wrong for me as a business person. And that has to be discussed among those stakeholders, because all of them have been given a gift. And with that gift, you need to be responsible. And I just want to voice that question. But the revenue is really important moving forward. We need to be honest. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Comments?
Yeah. No. There's a question on the chat I want to just circle back to. The question was, who's going to run the water system? And then they wanted kind of best case, worst case scenario for the taxes. So as we said before, when it comes to who we run the water system, legally, we have to have someone with a water license to run the system. You can't get that license until you've worked in the water system for a year. So the assumption is the town's going to take on some of the aqueduct employees, at least for the first year, as our wastewater treatment department kind of can study with them, learn with them, and then after a year get their own license and then potentially run it themselves if need be, or keep people on for the institution knowledge as well going forward. They'll fall within water and sewer department, below public works, then below municipal manager, then below select board, will be kind of how it flows. When it comes to the best case, worst case scenario for taxes, we're still at a point where we can't give a hard number because we have to A, decide what capital projects we want to use, and then how we want to allocate the funding. So that's part of the conversation tonight. It'll be part of the conversation Tuesday of next week. It's why we're having all these public forums so people can come, talk about what projects they want to see get done, and also potentially how they want to see the funds allocated as well, so the board has a better sense of community input as we go forward.
And I'd also just like to respond to the cost of the Vondel, because I know it's a contentious subject right now. I think that, you know, we're looking to the community to see if that is something that they want to pursue. Per the term sheet, we have to include it on the ballot. But if, you know, I guess what I'd say is that, you know, I understand the feelings and empathize with, you know, the idea that we're paying people out, but we don't. This land is could be an asset to the town, and I would like for folks to think of it like that. Whether or not we pay for it or someone else buys it from them, they will get paid. Do we still consider it a golden parachute? And that's why we want to hear from you guys. Truly, is to understand that, because I think that. Unfortunately, it's not illegal to run a bad business. I wish it were. And, you know, but I do think that the idea that that land could be an asset for the town. And so do we want to own it or do we not want to own it? Because we feel like it's unjust. And that's for you all to tell us, because, you know, it will be yours at the end of the day, or it won't be. And it helps to have your input. But I think that It also helps to look at it as whether or not it's valuable. And you know, we think it is. But yeah.
I will just say that I hear from constituents regularly who already utilize that land, you know, on a daily or weekly basis. And to many of them, it seems like an enormous asset for the town to preserve. So, you know, I'm just here to reflect what I'm hearing, and that's what I'm getting a lot of. So the more nuance and the more voices we can get in the conversation, the better.
Good evening, Kevin Lynch. Simple question. Describe to me how it is an asset for the taxpayers of Woodstock, Fondale Reservoir buying it. How is it an asset?
Sure. Well, I mean, I think in several ways. I think that having the land and owning the land could be with ours to do with if we want to preserve it for recreation. If we don't, if we want to have the rights to the reservoir in the future, then that would be valuable. If the townspeople don't want it, then, you know, by all means, vote against it. I think to Carrie's point, I've heard from a lot of people that it's valuable, and that they want it to be included. And again, if you don't feel that way, you don't feel that way.
Where does most of the water come from?
Right now, the water comes from the east end of the distribution system. It comes from the wells.
Wells off Stimmitz Road.
Yes, exactly.
So that's where most of the water comes from.
Yep.
Still confused. And so how it would be an asset for the taxpayers?
Look at, and I've been to some of these meetings, and everyone complains that the town hasn't done anything. Looking forward, it's always catch up. Well, at some point, not in our lifetime, but at some point, that you could put a water purification system and a pumping station at the bottom of that reservoir, and possibly, whether you agree with me or not, expand the water system west. So you could probably put in maybe a tract of land, you could put in some housing. It's not going to happen overnight, but if we don't own our property, it'll never happen. We need to look at the future. We can't just look at the next year. We've got to look 15, 20, 25 years down the road, and that's what we're trying to do.
It's 358 acres of land in Woodstock, Vermont, that the town could own or not own, and I think that's something that the town should consider.
Thank you.
Anyone else who hasn't spoken yet that wants to speak? Yeah.
Chris Miller. I've been resident of the village for 37 years. Two things. Well, first of all, I want to ask, is it your intention to decide tonight what goes on the ballot on the 29th?
So the ballot on the 29th is just going to be the acquisition.
Sorry, I'm sorry. The next one in December.
No, this is the start of the conversation. Yeah.
Two things. The first is, I think you need to take more seriously, or maybe you do already, the argument of for or against creating a water district wherein the users of the water system would take more of the burden of the cost of these things. Personally, I would be entirely against that, but I think it's a reasonable argument that reasonable people have been making, and we need to take it seriously. So how you present that, I think, is important. Secondly, the Vondale Reservoir. It's currently not supplying water to the system. I frankly do not believe that we'll ever supply water to the system. I think our money is much better spent on upgrading and creating new wells. I think that's the future of all water systems. I don't think that an open reservoir is ever going to be used. I think if it's not an infrastructure project, it certainly still has other value. But I think the decision on whether or not we buy that property should be divorced from the infrastructure projects. That we shouldn't conflate them, because people are going to be, I don't want to say confused, because that assumes they're not paying attention, but they will react to the Vondale Reservoir together with the other infrastructure projects, and they shouldn't, because I think buying or not buying the Vondale Reservoir is an entirely different argument for other reasons. I would be in favor of buying it myself, again. But I don't think, and I think that should be completely taken off the ballot, quite frankly. on the same ballot as the infrastructure projects, which I think we need to do. I'm entirely in favor of all of those. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. And if I could just make a comment of what he said, this is exactly why we're having these meetings, to get input like that, opinions on how the ballot should look like or what infrastructure. So thank you for your comments. We're trying to hold these to get the input from the community on what they want to see. That's a great insight. So thank you.
Can I?
Yeah.
Chris, do you mind if I just ask a question, a clarifying question? I just want to make sure I understand. For the ballot, we're, per the term sheet, we're obligated to have the Vondel on the ballot, but would it?
We're obligated to have a vote on the Vondel by a certain time.
By a certain time. Would you be in favor of having two ballot articles, two separate ballot articles, one for separate the Vondel and then one for capital projects?
Personally, I'd rather not have them on the same day. I've been in so many votes where
you
one thing on the ballot.
You might step up to.
Okay, sorry. This is my doing because I asked the
question. 37 years of being here in Woodstock, we've been in so many votes where there are several things on the ballot, and one item on the ballot everybody hates, and so they vote all the rest of them down.
Okay.
I think this should be separate, entirely separate.
Okay, thank you.
Online?
Not that I'm seeing. I think, the both, one.
Yeah.
I would, John King, I would agree with Chris that it should be separated. And I suspect the reason that's being connected to two, they want to get rid of that asset as part of the deal.
Can I respond to that quickly?
Sure.
The original goal, as we talked about before, was to have one big vote altogether in November with the acquisition, the Vondel, and the capital projects as one big single vote. When the state came in with the grant funding and the time change, we had to shift and have one vote for the acquisition by October 31st. And then get the grant funding, and then we schedule another vote for everything else, just because we were trying to get it to go. That's why it's been scheduled that way.
Right. Yeah, because I think it complicates the issue. We need to buy the water system. I suspect the reason they want the 1.6 is they, not selling it as a package. It's not for this month. I don't know if it's in current use or whatever.
Yes.
So I really have an issue with the 1.6 million. I would propose negotiations that how long do they own the company? 135 years. I would recommend a $1 a year lease for 130 years, the length of time that they owned it. I don't understand if we're not using it. They're putting a value of 1.6. They've had current use advantage of it. I really think it's going to complicate the whole issue. There's going to be some responsibilities of the conditions that it's in. And I see this as a massive reward. I think it's an ethical, moral issue of the condition and giving this to the town. But I think it should be separated. But I also a lease option for the time that they've owned it. Was that property part of the water company for all time? How long has the water company owned that?
I don't have the data in front of me, but I'm guessing a very long time.
Yeah. For the time of the water company, correct? Right.
I assume knowing the family, I was serving the family for a very long time.
Yeah. I would consider a lease option. It's an ethical, moral question. To have a current use property that you've had tax advantages for so long, and you're under current use, you really can't develop it. I personally think that's an issue. I don't know what the consultants are saying, but this is a big deal. It's the community here, but just a consideration there.
Okay.
Yeah.
I guess that was part of the question. I got to answer return use. I was just wondering how much off the tax rolls that property is going to cost us in taxes as well, and lost taxes. What's it zoned for? Is that zoned for residential for how many units? Could they possibly then be purchased, sold off in lots, and then that would create housing there as well too? So I run up Mount Tom quite a bit. I run on Mount Peg. I know people mountain bike. Again, I grew up in Vermont. There's wonderful trail. I don't know if we need to reserve more open space that maybe could become housing.
I know it's a beautiful space up there, and I know the mountain bikers have done well. I don't think anyone swims in that reservoir, so I'm not quite sure, but a nice house overlooking
it. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so I guess that's what I would say by acquiring that property, what comes off the tax rolls, and then also what development is limited. I mean, again, that could be a great spot to increase our tax rolls because affordable housing will create one rate of taxes, but a couple, you know, $5 or $6 $2 million homes up there is going to really increase our tax roll. So I guess let's not take it away from potential development to increase taxes. Not that I want to see any more development, but if it's done tastefully with 300 some odd acres, I'm sure there can be some, and that may be on them to do that. But whatever, I think you're taking that property off the tax rolls, which is only exacerbates the revenue needed to pay for infrastructures that have been neglected. Sorry.
So the current appraisal on Vondel is about $13,000. And taxes, the overall taxes that the aqueduct pays the town is about $38,000. So that's what we'll be losing in overall revenue. The town pays now about $50,000 in debt service to the aqueduct to pay off their debts. So when we wipe off that debt with the $920,000, that money will go away from our bills, your bills and user bills. So it is a kind of a net positive right there, like, you know, $12,000, give or take some money on how that works. So that's kind of the difference right now. Your second question was development of Vondel. So the terms with the aqueduct company is that the town is purchasing the Vondel with no restrictions on it. So the town, by acquiring it, can have total control over it if they choose. If the town chooses to put it in conservation, then there are funds available to help offset that cost. That'll be a conversation that we have to have as well, and what we want to do with this future. So the scenario will buy for 1.6, and then the town owns it. It can do whatever it wants with it in the future, keep it in conservation, use it for conservation, or have, you know, development or whatever else they want. Or they could put it in conservation through the Vermont Land Trust or something else and get some state money and other donations to kind of offset the $1.6 million.
Is that served by sewer,
town
sewer, or is that have to be a septic?
Septic, yeah.
Well, I'd be in favor of that, either go to private developers. And then again, the town would have control. It's not going to be an ugly development. I mean, we only have to look at it across from the high school, how hard people had to fight to put that affordable housing in. How demonized people were that were going to move in there. They were going to bring drugs to our town and bring. There was a lot of negative against that. That was disappointing, and I would like to think that if with Garrish property ever gets developed into affordable housing, or if that area is then put onto our tax rolls, you know, we all rise when the tax when our capital. You know, the worth of the capital goes up in town. We pay less taxes as a person.
Anything on mine?
You don't say anything.
Any other questions? Hey, thank you. Do we want to go into?
Yes. So we're going to executive session. I will say tomorrow morning, 9 a.m., a few of us will be at Sophie Good Cafe. Tomorrow at 4 p.m., we'll be at the Atacucci Yacht Club. And then Tuesday, Monday morning, we'll be at South Woodstock at 9 a.m. Tuesday, we'll be at Abracadabra at 9 a.m. Psych board meeting at 1 p.m. here to talk about funding options. And then Greg Fulton and Susan Ford will be at the South Woodstock fire station at 5:30 on Tuesday. Is that right, Greg?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's about 6 opportunities in the next 4 days for us to continue this conversation. So please keep coming. Please keep with your comments, insights. We're happy to keep talking. Do you have one last thing?
One more quick question. Simple yes or no. Has any private company expressed an interest in taking over the aqueduct?
We don't have that information because that would be a private conversation between the aqueduct and that private company. What I will say is when the town seriously considered this and we signed a letter with the aqueduct to go in negotiations, it was an understanding that there were other potential parties looking at that time.
Looking at owning it privately.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Well, I would entertain a motion to enter executive session under 1 BSA 313 to discuss personnel issues.
No contractual risk.
Contract, okay. Discuss contracts after making a finding that premature general public knowledge would clearly place the public body or a person involved at a substantial disadvantage.
I will make the motion.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you. We do need to stay. Do you want to, maybe 15 minutes? Or do you want to?
Not recording.
Just saying we need like United Nations. Like YouTube.
Okay, next up is a motion to approve the minutes of September 17th, September 23rd, and September 25th. Motion?
I make a motion to accept them.
Second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? Aye.
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 Okay. Motion to adjourn.
Make a motion to adjourn.
The second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
We're adjourned.
Nice.